Hello everyone. Today we're going to talk about Gaussian random vectors. The prerequisites for this material is the material on covariance matrices and on principal component analysis. The goal is to define Gaussian random vectors and to explain their connection to principal component analysis and provide some geometric intuition about what their density looks like. The PDF of a Gaussian random variable with mean mu and standard deviation sigma is given by this exponential squared, as we already saw. Remember that mu and sigma are parameters, but they are also actually equal to the mean and the standard deviation of the distribution. The generalization to vectors is given by the following joint PDF. So a Gaussian random vector X has a joint PDF of this form, where essentially we have a quadratic form here inside an exponential function. And this depends on two parameters, the mean mu and the covariance matrix sigma. Sigma is a covariance matrix, so it has to be symmetric. And also its eigenvalues have to be positive, because remember that the eigenvalues are equal to the variance of the principal components, and the variance cannot be negative. Okay, so any positive, any symmetric positive definite matrix can be a covariance matrix of a Gaussian random vector. And as we will see, the geometry of the density is essentially governed by the covariance matrix, whereas this parameter mu just tells us where the density is centered. Remember that also in the case of Gaussian random variables, the mean mu just tells you where it's centered. In order to understand this geometry a little bit better, let's take a look at the set of points at which the PDF is constant. And we're going to assume that we're centered at the origin. Just to make things easy, we're just going to assume that mu is equal to zero. So if mu is equal to zero, the set of points at which the PDF is constant is just given by the set of points where the quadratic form inside the exponential is equal to a constant. Okay, but realize that the only dependence on x here is inside this exponential, and it's governed by this quadratic form. Okay, so when this quadratic form is equal to a constant, that's the set of points at which the PDF is constant. Now, we're going to express the quadratic form in terms of the eigendecomposition of the covariance matrix. So the covariance matrix is a symmetric matrix, so it has an eigendecomposition of this form, where U contains the eigenvectors in its columns, and the matrix lambda is a diagonal matrix that contains the eigenvalues. The inverse, just by simple linear algebra, is equal to U lambda inverse U transpose. And this is because this is a symmetric matrix, so U is an orthogonal matrix, where the inverse is equal to the transpose. Okay, in any case, this is the equation that we're left with. This equals to a constant. If we expand this product, what we get is basically this equation, where, I mean, just to show you why this holds, x transpose, so u transpose x is just equal to u1 transpose x down to ud transpose x. Okay, and in this product here, what we have is a row vector, which is u1 transpose x onto ud transpose x. We're hitting a diagonal matrix that has 1 over the eigenvalues in its diagonal. And then we're hitting another vector, which is u1 transpose x, ud transpose x. Okay? And what happens here is basically that what you get is a sum of this guy times this guy times this guy plus the second guy times the second guy times the second guy down to the last guy times the last guy times the last guy, and this is this sum here. Okay, you can just try it out, try to compute it out at home. What's interesting is that this is exactly the equation of an ellipsoid that has axes in the directions of these eigenvectors, and the width of the ellipsoid, sorry, the length of the ellipsoid along those axes is given by the square root of the eigenvalues. Let's take a look at a concrete example. Here we have a Gaussian random vector with mean 0 and this covariance matrix. We take an eigendecomposition. These are the eigenvalues. These are the eigenvectors. And now, because of what we have just said, we know that the contours of the PDF, these lines along which the PDF is equal to a constant, are going to be ellipses, and the axes of the ellipses are going to be given by these two vectors. And along the first vector, the ellipse is going to be much more elongated than along the second one. Okay, so this is exactly what we see here. The ellipse in this direction is much more elongated than in this direction. This is given by the eigenvector corresponding to the largest eigenvalue. This is the direction of the eigenvector with the smallest eigenvalue. Okay, and these are the contour lines of the PDF, where the PDF is constant. So that's how you have to think about the joint PDF of a Gaussian random vector in d dimensions. It's basically concentric ellipsoids, and how elongated the ellipsoid is in different directions is given by the eigenvectors of the covariance matrix of the Gaussian random vector. Now let's see what happens if the entries of the Gaussian random vector are uncorrelated. So remember that the covariance matrix has a diagonal where you get the variances of each entry, and in the off diagonal we get the covariance of the entries between the different entries of the random vector. If all the entries are uncorrelated, then the off diagonal elements are all zero in the covariance matrix. Well, if that happens for a Gaussian random vector, then the entries of the Gaussian random vector are independent, not only uncorrelated. This, of course, only happens for Gaussian random vectors because we have already shown examples for which uncorrelation does not imply independence. So let's prove why this is the case only for Gaussian random vectors. In the case where we have uncorrelation, the inverse of the covariance matrix is also diagonal. Okay, it's the inverse of this matrix here. This is a diagonal matrix, so its inverse is also a diagonal matrix with the inverse of the diagonal entries in its diagonal. Okay, it also, just by linear algebra, if you have a diagonal matrix and you compute its determinant, because remember that the determinant also appears in the expression for the joint PDF, then the determinant is just equal to the product of the entries in the diagonal. So with this in place, if we have a joint, if we take a look at the joint PDF of a Gaussian random vector whose entries are uncorrelated, what we're going to see is, well, this is the general expression that we had seen before. Now here, this is going to be a diagonal matrix, and here this is just going to be a product of the diagonal entries. Okay, because this is a diagonal matrix, we again, as in the case of what we derived a moment ago, the equation of the ellipsoid, we have this situation where this product just reduces to the square of the entries in this vector times the diagonal in this, the entries of the diagonal of this matrix. And we have this sum here. And again, here we have the product of the entries because we have the determinant here. So now what happens is that because, again, this guy is diagonal, so that this product, there's no cross, this means that there's not going to be any cross factors in this sum, okay, otherwise there would be. Because of that, we can express this as a product of the exponential functions for each of them, okay, for each entry here, and the whole joint PDF factors into an expression that only depends on each of the entries, which has to correspond to the marginal of the Gaussian random vector. Notice that the marginal is actually a Gaussian with a mean mu in the ith entry on mu, and a variance sigma I squared. This is not a coincidence, because as we'll see in a moment, the entries of a Gaussian random vector, and in fact any linear combination of the entries of a Gaussian random vector, is also Gaussian. But the important part to notice here is that when you take a look at the joint PDF, if this guy, if the covariance matrix is diagonal, then this quadratic form just becomes a sum of quadratic terms, each of which only depend on one entry, which means that we can split the exponential into a product of exponentials, and each of them only depend on one of the entries, so that then this means that that is equal to a product of the marginals, okay? And each of the marginals is just a Gaussian that depends on that particular entry. Because the joint PDF factors into the product of the marginals, this means that the entries of the random vector are jointly independent. So as I said a moment ago, if you have a Gaussian random vector with a certain mean and a certain covariance, if you apply a deterministic matrix and you sum a vector, then the distribution remains Gaussian. We proved this in the scalar case. In the vector case, the proof is actually very similar, except that you have to use multivariate calculus, and it gets a bit clunkier, but the idea is exactly the same. We're not going to prove it explicitly. And the mean is given by A mu plus B, and the covariance matrix is A sigma A transpose. Okay. So what we're going to apply this result to, well, by the way, we already kind of saw that this result holds at least for the marginals. So now, if it's true that a linear combination of the entries of the Gaussian random vector are Gaussian, and it is true, then if you look at the principal components, remember, the first principal component is equal to U1 transpose X, where U1 is the first eigenvector of the covariance matrix. The second one is U2 transpose X down to UD transpose X, okay? So that this vector is just given by U transpose X, where U has the eigenvectors as columns. So this means basically that the principal components are a linear combination of the entries of the random vector, and in particular their Gaussian, and their covariance matrix, as we saw here, the covariance matrix is given by A sigma A transpose. The covariance matrix is given by U transpose sigma U, and if you remember, sigma is equal to U lambda U transpose, because that's the eigendecomposition, so that the covariance matrix of the principal components is a diagonal matrix. This means that the principal components are uncorrelated, which, by the way, we already proved in the notes on the covariance matrix, and because of that, and because of the fact that this is a Gaussian random vector, in the case of Gaussian random vectors, the principal components are independent. And this is not the case for any other kind of vector, so that's important to remember, because remember that in other cases we have shown that uncorrelated random variables can be dependent. So now to finish, I want to mention the fact that if you compute the log likelihood of the Gaussian parameters of a Gaussian random vector, okay, you take, you have n independent d-dimensional samples, and you want to compute the mean and the covariance matrix based on those d-independent samples, the computations get slightly more complicated than in the scalar case, but what happens basically is that the solution is the sample mean and the sample actually here we should say the sample covariance matrix. So basically this idea of taking the data, computing the sample covariance matrix, computing the eigenvectors and eigenvalues, which is what PCA is about, that's principal components analysis, you can interpret this as saying, okay, let's assume that these data are Gaussian, and now let's take a look at how are these, like, how do these ellipsoids look like that form the density of the Gaussian. In order to do that, you have to estimate the covariance matrix. If you estimate it using maximum likelihood, then you build the sample covariance matrix, and then you take the eigendecomposition to look at the axis of the ellipsoid and how stretched out the ellipsoid is in the direction of each of its axes. So that's an interpretation of principal component analysis as if we were assuming that the data were Gaussian. However, as we have already seen, for example, with the Canadian city dataset, PCA, or with the faces, PCA is very useful even with the data when the data don't look anything like Gaussian. And definitely the Canadian cities or this face dataset are nothing close to Gaussian. So it's important to remember that. Even though you can interpret PCA as coming from the maximum likelihood estimate for the parameters of a Gaussian random vector, that does not mean that it is not useful when we apply to non-Gaussian data. It's just that we have to understand that in that case, we're getting the variance in different directions. It's not really about the density of the data itself. It's more about the variance in different directions. Okay, so what have we learned here? We have defined Gaussian random vectors and we have connected them to principal component analysis and hopefully acquired a bit of a geometric interpretation of their density. Thank you very much.